Good afternoon. We are from Manipal Hospital, Dwarka. We're going to talk about coronavirus and how it affects respiratory system. Then we are going to discuss the salient radiological features of coronavirus infection. And then also we are going to have few questions about microbiological aspect of coronavirus and how to diagnose and manage the infection control. So as we all know, coronavirus are a large family of viruses that cause illness ranging from common cold to more severe diseases. It was earlier in the form of MERS and SARS, but since 2019, it has been called COVID-19 because it was discovered in 19 as a new strain of pre-existing virus. It is an RNA virus which closely resembles original SARS virus, but it has almost 96% genetic resemblance to that original coronavirus which had been existing before. Resemblance to coronavirus seen in pangolins. So these exotic animals, they were supposed to be the vector for this virus, and because of this mutation, it has started from Wuhan. How does coronavirus spread? Is mainly through a droplet infection, and people get infection by touching these objects or surfaces, and that is the reason it should be, it is important for us to stay about 1 meter away from these patients. Can COVID be, apart from person who has got no symptoms? That is actually true, because although the risk of catching COVID from someone with no symptoms is very low, but still, since many people have only mild symptoms in early stages of diseases, it is possible that we can get infection or viral infection from someone who has just got mild cough and is not actually reporting ill. There are clinical symptoms which are very classical of any viral infection. It usually occurs from 2 to 14 days after exposure, with mild to severe respiratory illness, fever and tiredness. Dry cough and shortness of breath are hallmark of this particular disease, along with body ache and nausea and sometimes diarrhea. More than 80% recover spontaneously from these symptoms, and they do not need any special treatment like all other viral infections. But in severe cases, which are almost less than 2%, we require hospitalization because of pneumonia, SARS, kidney failure or death. Diagnosis is mainly upon epidemiological history, if you have history of travel to particular place and clinical manifestation. And then the detection by RT-PCR, Dr. Naveen from microbiology is going to talk about that in a while. And radiology section is to be taken by Dr. Behra. Then we will be seeing how we can diagnose COVID infection based on these tests. COVID symptoms are almost similar to flu and cold, but there are certain differences in coronavirus infection compared to flu and cold. Dry cough and fever is quite common in both flu and COVID, but it's less common in common cold, whereas runny nose and sore throat is more common in seasonal cold, which we have along with body aches and sneezes. There are certain high-risk populations like elderly, diabetic and chronic smokers, or those with underlying lung disease. Healthcare workers in particular have got a very high viral load because of the long duration of exposure to the viral infections per se. And also there is a cardiorespiratory illness because this virus does affect the cardiac function. Almost 55% of doctors or healthcare workers, they get infection from healthcare facility only. There is something called a cytokine storm or hypoxia, which is the main cause of death in coronavirus infection, which is ARDS, because it triggers a violent attack by the immune system to the body. The mechanism is still unclear, and the patient initially appears very comfortable, although very severely hypoxic. Treatment is still supportive care and peritreatment. Hydroxychloroquine is one which has been noted, along with antivirals, although the benefits are unclear as of now. And there are a large number of trials that are underway, and vaccine is also awaited. Hydroxychloroquine basically was proven to be efficacious based on one study which came from China, about 62 patients, where hydroxychloroquine showed that there was a significant reduction in body temperature once they were given to these patients, and there were improvement radiologically also. So that is the reason, but large scale clinical research is still needed. A trial of lopinavir and ritonavir failed in severe COVID patients, and it did not significantly accelerate clinical improvement. And the studies are still underway to see the complete efficacy. Final few slides about how to manage your OPDs in case we have coronavirus patients. You should have a strict appointment system, a limited number of patients. we should give masks to patients and relatives. And I think Dr. Ravi will talk about infection control policies in detail. Similarly, inside Dr. Chamber, we need to have clear proper PP and we need to minimize paperwork as much as possible. So I think now we will just take some questions and we'll start with a few major questions about microbiological aspect of coronavirus infection. So Dr. Ravi, what could be the mode of transmission of SARS-CoV virus, and is there any change in understanding that this virus could be airborne? And can this virus be controlled?
Hi, good afternoon. Thank you, Dr. Puneet, for such giving wide picture of the micro coronavirus pathology and also management. Relates to the pertinent questions related to diagnosis, and this is the commonly been asked to us is what's the mode of transmission. As you know, the primary mode of transmission is droplet, and it can be transmitted through the direct contact. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about droplet transmission, it means when we're coughing and sneezing, then the particles which comes out, which is more than 5 micron in size, and meaning that the virus will be there. And also, if the patient is infected and the surrounding environment is contaminated, so through the the fomites contact, which we call it. So, and normally this droplet transmission is considered that to be in the range of 1 meter of a patient who has, or a person I can say, infected and in the coughing and sneezing. So that's the common mode of transmission which been considered in case of the SARS coronavirus 2. But obviously on and off, we get a noise that could be airborne or not. And there is one publication where there has shown that in experimental conditions the virus can remain for 3 hours in the environment, and they have found it to be positive. But till now, it's airborne transmission has been documented only in aerosol generating procedure, where bronchoscopy, where you are prone to aerosol containing SARS coronavirus if the person is infected. Other than that, even if it's experimental condition where they are talking about, where if they found the virus in the environment, finding just RNA of the virus doesn't mean the virus is transmissible. So till now, based on information, the virus is still considered to be droplet transmissible virus, and aerosol transmission is probable but not been proven till now, as such, in a normal conditions. So now coming to the second part of the first question, which is, can it be transmitted by the other route other than the respiratory route? There is one report of intestinal, because this virus has got a presentations different than respiratory symptoms also. Patients do present with And in one publication, they have found that the virus has been isolated from a stool specimen. Yes. But again, the persistence and other thing has not been studied. It's a new virus. Still, we are learning about this. But till now, there is no documented report of any fecal odor transmission at this moment. But yes, this virus can be isolated from a stool based on the report available to now.
So I'll just interject in between to the audience who are listening to us that they can just post their questions on the chat box if there are additional questions related to coronavirus. Sir, in connection with this, how effective is the mask, and which particular mask is more important for the airborne transmission or for the remote transmission?
Absolutely. I mean, this is a very pertinent question and always been, as WHO and CDC recommends, and various other bodies also recommend that for the routine practice, if you're just dealing with the routine care, triple layer, good quality, I'll always say good quality triple layer surgical mask is sufficient to prevent droplet transmission. Mm-hmm. But again, in a high risk area where you are, where there's particularly in the respiratory OPD, and since we are still learning, there is a probability, we don't know. I mean, N95 mask could be a reasonable option. I can say the good options to have
airborne
to prevent airborne transmission. So yes, but again, the contingency is also a question, and supply is also a big challenge at this moment. in that situation.
So basically, the message is that N95 may not be required for every case.
Absolutely.
So we can just give it for airborne transmission or high-risk cases.
High-risk cases, yes.
And otherwise, it's triple layer
surgical mask
is for more. So the next question is, what we all know that PCR, RT-PCR is the principal standard of diagnosis. So what are the precautions which clinicians should take before sending such samples? And what are the challenges with this?
Absolutely, because at the moment, you know, this is the primary mode of diagnosis. So most important is to send adequate sample, because the first thing, you know, in any microbiological diagnosis is that good quality sample improve the yield of the virus or, you know, any organism. So safety of the healthcare worker is very important. We are collecting the samples and the good quality samples. When I say good quality, it means, you know, it should be the nose and throat swab combined at this moment. Though I will come to the next questions on what is the sensitivity of different samples. So primary patients, if it's, you know, it's presenting to us in early, you know, early days of the symptoms, then nose and throat swab is a good samples. Good, you know, this basically
virus shedding is more in the
absolutely, early. Absolutely. And the thing is, we're talking about nasal swab, then it should be basically collected from the, you know, the at least from the nasal mucosa, or you can go inside of, you know, at least because these viruses are attached to the epithelial cells, so that should be there, you know, in
along. Isn't one swab from one nostril and one from another? You need to take two, or you can take similar one from air.
I think similar one can be taken from both.
From both the nostrils.
Yeah, and then you're talking about throat swab, then obviously it's a different swab.
It's a different swab from throat.
Yeah.
So when we take from throat, some people say that it has to be taken from tongue. So is it for base of tongue or it is back of the throat?
I think back of the throat is, you know, that you can say the posterior pharyngeal wall, they can reach to, but again, with the gag.
There's a gag.
So
some people take it from tonsillar.
It's a tonsillar mucosa. Yeah, that is a sample which is should be taken. So
among all these samples, what is the sensitivity of the food samples and how we should take the low respiratory tract?
Yeah, that is a very good question, because we do. No, we listen. Well, we hear about that. You know, this earlier sample was negative, then it turned out to be positive, or you know that kind of. So yes, at the moment, you know, can I just put in this one slide is there, which I have. You know, there's one good publications where they have shown sensitivity of. There's a good publications in, I mean, like, I'm not going to show to the, you know, the, so it's a, in JAMA, where it's published in March, and they have shown sensitivity based on the, you know, different samples. So if you see that BAL has got 93% positivity overall, bronchial villi lavage, and, you know, the commonly collected sample is nasal swab, which has got, you know, sensitivity of 63%. And combined nasal pharyngeal swab has got, you know, the pharyngeal swab alone has 32%. So that's
but when we combine, then this
sensitivity improves 70% around. You can say sensitivity of combined nose and throat swab.
Is there any blood test for it?
Yes, we do have blood test available, and again, you know, we do have all this antibody testing, which is
no, not the antibody testing. I mean the blood culture. Or the viral culture, is it being done routinely for these?
Viral cultures are still limited for the tertiary, you know, for the, what do you say?
Academic
centers and the research lab, because, you know, it's a new virus and should not be cultured in a routine lab where the viral cultures are available. So blood, definitely they have isolated. This can be, yes. So you can say the blood, it's quite low yield of the virus.
The challenge with actually bronchoalveolar lavage is that it is an aerosol spreading procedure.
Yes.
So most of these patients either will be very, very sick when we
absolutely.
Right.
I think this one, you know, the BAL becomes significant if the, because if the patient develops pneumonia and, you know, in that patients, you may have a nose and throat swab negative. You know, so less commonly. So in that situations, if a negative is still clinically suspected patient sick enough. And it ventilated in those situations, BAL can be taken up. Yes.
And what is the role of antibody testing? Because we heard that it was, you know, coming initially, ELISA-based antibody testing was happening, but then it was withdrawn by ICMR because of some skill issues. So,
yeah.
What is the current status and what is the logic behind doing antibody?
Yeah. I think, you know, any virus when it infects is just, you know, it's basically generate immune response in the body and body mount immune response in term of earlier as IgA and IgM and IgG. But again, you know, how much these antibodies are mounted in a person and it differs from different viruses. Some will have a good quality of antibodies in the blood detectable by the different assays available. Particularly in this, you know, in the SARS-CoV-2 infections, the assay which are developed, I can say of moderate, moderate, you can say accuracy at this moment, and still the rapid test which has been designed, it also differs with the different manufacturers and how and the different platforms where it is being used for. So the rapid tests, which are some of them, has got productivity issues, and they are turned out to be more causing false positive. So these challenges are still there, and you know, it's getting worked upon. So hopefully in the future we'll have a good quality assay, which will have a better sensitivity and specificity, and can be introduced as a routine test in a patients who presented late in the clinical.
As I understand, they are point of care blood tests, basically.
There are point of care blood tests. There are ELISA based tests also, but still they
are. There are rapid tests for nasal swab also.
Still in experimental stage, but not available as a routine diagnostic test at this moment.
Because going forward, it may be possibly be required for airlines for.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There are a lot of work going on to have a point of care test which can detect antigen in the nose in a respiratory sample.
And what is the way forward to improve diagnostic accuracy for all the tests if we can do that?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question, because we understand all the assay has got limitations, and none of the assay can be 100% sensitive and specific. It's a new virus. We are always been in a situations to rule out as much we can. So the way forward will be to have a combined test as a molecular test as well as antibody test available, so that whoever, either PCR is negative, then we can do the antibody test, good quality antibody test combined with help in terms of picking up as much early infection possible. So that's the way forward.
Yeah, and I think just final few questions about how to take preventions in terms of control of infection, particularly those who are listening, maybe having their own OPDs or maybe starting their OPDs at home or clinics. So what basic precautions they should take to prevent spread of infection and for disinfection of the OPDs person?
Yeah, I think it's very important, and thing is, we need to know that this virus is going to stay with us for
we have to live
with this virus. It's not going to go away. It's obviously, if you see, the mode of transmission is your mucosal surfaces, right. So that has to be protected. Triple layer surgical mask. If you are more, try to be more cautious, you can wear a 95 mask if it's available. There are many, the guidance is coming out for reuse, but how much effective they are at this moment is a very difficult question to answer. But can we reuse? So mask and hand hygiene, frequent hand hygiene, taking care of your eyes, and I think that's routine care should be. Frequent cleaning of the area to prevent virus to be present on the on the surfaces.
Our physicians who are running their OPDs at clinic. So what kind of solution? 1% hypochlorite is the
1% sodium hypochlorite freshly prepared is the ideal solution. Even alcohol.
How frequently should it be?
I think every 3 to 4 hours will be a good way to move forward at this moment.
And another question people very frequently ask is whether fumigation is required or whether it is useful, or if required, how frequently we should use it.
I think absolutely, this question always been asked, and the fumigation is one thing which is not routinely required in any clinical area. More recent guidance always discourage fumigations because it just gives you a false sense of satisfaction. Fumigation has very limited indications. If there is any new area, or you can say the new, or any engineering has been done in those situations, it will be. So routine fumigation has no role. Terminal cleaning involves cleaning of all the surfaces, including, your chairs, furniture, door handles, wall. That's the thing which needs to be done rather than fumigation. So.
Right. Thank you so much, Dr. Ravi.
I have one question.
Yes,
yes, sir.
My radiology investigation are dependent on your positivity. Now the present scenario, what is the positive rate of coronavirus?
Sensitivity of sensitivity overall, yeah. Sir, sensitivity of PCR test is overall, if we say, because it all depends upon the time of detection, type of sample taken, and you know how the PCR is being performed. Different PCR performs differently. Overall, you can say 70-80%.
This also depends if the viral load is high.
Absolutely, a lot of
factors. Because the MSCT repeated in the city in a suspected cases, negative still CT is indicated. This is one of the conditions I am asking. Secondly, you said about the disinfecting the room. What about the patient waiting area? But in my department, I have a lot of patient waiting area. A lot of patients are coming along with the attendance. They may be positive, asymptomatic positive. They are sitting there.
I think that's question will be for all those people who are running their individual OPDs coming to the more or less same.
Yeah.
Frequent cleaning of all the areas with any disinfectant. You know, freshly prepared sodium hypochlorite is a good one. There are quaternary ammonium compound which is widely available. So cleaning of the area every 3 to 4 hours is a good way to prevent patients. And hand hygiene is more important, sir. If you're just, you know, because it's more your hand which definitely, you know, transmits rather than, the respiratory route. So, the respiratory secretions, direct respiratory secretion I'm talking about. So, yes, hand hygiene, frequent cleaning of the area, of furniture and all the, surfaces will be the ideal way of preventing doing adequate decontamination.
See, why I ask? Because it's our moral responsibility to avoid transmission.
Yes.
The testing area. We are not going to, we have hand hygiene. What about the healthy visitors who are sitting there?
Yes, symptomatic presentations.
So for example, the very, very important events,
social distancing, sir. Social distancing has to be there. And also when you are coming, that's why you protect all the mucosal surfaces, respiratory route, hand hygiene and decontamination.
And I think more
important question I have about my CT rooms in ultrasound. They are the closed rooms, meaning closed ventilation, they have operators. Any positive patients coming, you see, once they exhale the virus, they are supposed to get lost somewhere and supposed to cause the sanctuary of virus. This is the idea. That's why after positive patients, you are doing CT scan or ultrasound, which is positive, that room has to be decontaminated properly. So apart from the surface, the room need to be given at least aerosol spray followed by 1 hour complete lockdown and passive bare ventilation tap.
So that is the idea, because in a pandemic, every patient is assumed to be positive unless proven otherwise. And the best thing is to have a mask for your healthcare worker.
Yeah, that is healthcare as well as patient. For both of them, the mask is mandatory.
So
and positive cases, we have to do these preventive measures, not to avoid even the healthy individuals who are in the department.
So I think now we are going to talk about chest imaging in coronavirus diseases, and Dr. Behra, our head of radiology.
Thank you, Puneet and Naureen, for initial part of the coronavirus disease. Now I will take up the imaging parts of the coronavirus disease. Apart from that, I go very basic about the how to prevent the disease process in my department, as well as
questions,
as well as various imaging findings, particular X-ray and CT very frequently used, and their efficacy, followed by few images, some critical images where you don't expect coronavirus disease, still they are there. So, topic of chest imaging in coronavirus disease. Coronavirus disease is a pandemic disease started in December 2019 at Wuhan, now with worldwide spread. It is an airborne, highly contagious disease. COVID-19 has very high mortality and morbidity rate. Extremes of age less than 10 years, above 65 years, are the more vulnerable group. Strict preventive measures are required to avoid infection or to contain the disease process. COVID-19 positive patients can spread disease to staff as well as healthy patients and visitors in the radiology department. Radiology workers frequently come in contact with patients and can contract infection knowing unknowingly from undetected COVID patients. Asymptomatic staff with COVID-19 infection can spread to non-infected patients or healthy visitors in the radiology department as well as fellow workers unknowingly. That's imaging rooms like CT scan, ultrasound rooms, X-ray rooms can harbor viruses for hours, days due to poor ventilation and may serve as sanctuary for the viruses. These are the drawback of radiology department. What are the preventive measures should take? Strict patient screening prior to radiological investigation. That's why we have to see that part. Somebody has fever and cough, possibly you should not deal with this and should suspect COVID fast in our pandemic situations. Strict social distancing for staff and patients. Strict hand sanitization by staff before and after examination of patients. Strict and effective utilization of available masks or PPE for staff as well as patients as applicable. Strict drill to be followed by examining patients. We all have strict drill in our ultrasound, CT as well as while doing portable X-ray in the ward with suspected patients. Proper sterilization or sanitization of equipment and examination rooms after examination of COVID-19 or suspected COVID-19 patients. There are the various preventive measures we have to help we avoid disease contamination. Chest imaging COVID patients, effective imaging tools are X-ray, CT scan, and ultrasound. X-ray is most widely available and frequently used imaging tool, easy to operate, and does not require radiologists to perform, and images can be instantly seen with digital format. Similar set CT scans, not imaging tool for initial evaluation of COVID patients, provide excellent depiction of pathological lesions even in its very early stage. Real problem lies in patient mobilization and sanitization of equipment and equipment rooms. Ultrasound of chest, an effective tool for initial imaging as well as subsequent follow-up, but a very much operator dependent tool with individual skill in chest imaging. Correlation of chest, this is one of the largest report in March this year. Various X-ray findings in patient with confirmed COVID. It was a retrospective observational study of largest series published in March 2020. Total number of 636 patients. Sample type patient visiting urgent care or emergency department with confirmed COVID-19. Total number of COVID-19 cases studied with 636. Normal X-ray 371. 58.93% they reported as a normal patient in early stage. Abnormal X-ray 265, 41.7%. And severity was mild in 195, 30.7% was in milder form. Moderate is 65, 10.2%. And severe form was only 5%, 0.8%. These are the presentation in 636 cases. Various X-ray findings in these cases, interstitial changes 151, 23.7% patients presented interstitial like septal thickening, bronchovascular prominent, bronchovascular markings like other linear shadows. Ground glass opacities or what you say GGOs was 120, 18.9%. Lower lobe location 215, 33.8% of the patients had a lower lobe predominance. Bilateral location 133 about 20.9% bilateral infiltration, multifocal 150 24.2%. Effusion and lymphadenopathy are uncommon in these cases. CT scan COVID, this is ICRI guidelines and recommendation. Suspected case not recommended except RT-PCR negative with strong history of contact with COVID-19 patient and having clinical deterioration. So if it is positive, not required. If it is negative PCR test, still you are suspecting clinically, then only CT scan is recommended. proven case. CT should be used sparingly and reserved for hospitalized patients with specific clinical indication like organizing pneumonia versus ARDS. CT should not be used to screen COVID-19 patients as first line test to diagnose COVID-19. This is the recommendation of ICMR. Further, CT does not get diagnostic value. Positive results can only be believed if the pre-test probability of the disease is high. Using CT for diagnosis is not known to provide clinical benefit and could lead to false security if results are negative. If COVID-19 is suspected, patients should be isolated pending confirmation with PCR test multiple times or until quarantine has lapsed. CT scan do not change this findings. CT findings in COVID-19 patients, up to 50% of patients with COVID-19 infection may have normal CT scan within 0 to 2 days after onset of flu-like symptoms from COVID-19. Ground glass opacities and consolidation with or without vascular enlargement, interlobular septal thickening, and air bronchogram sign are common CT features of COVID-19 patients. GGO forms the major bulk, about 50 to 75% of the findings. Crazy paving and consolidation are the dominant CT finding, peaking around 9 to 13 days, followed by slow clearing. The last finding. Chest X-ray and CT features of COVID-19. The classical findings is ground glass opacities, consolidation, crazy paving, and reverse halo sign. They have got peripheral, multiple, bilateral, lower dominant. The probable findings are bronchocentric, peripheral consolidation, less of GGO or reverse halo. Indeterminate, confidence level is there less than 70%. Not so classical findings, some changes but not sure, but not normal, badly done X-rays or artifact. These are the various questions here, we are not sure. Your level is a constant level less than 70%. And non-COVID, there is 70% confidence for alternative diagnosis like lower pneumonia, effusion, pneumothorax, pulmonary edema. These are here, you are not suspecting a COVID. And normal, no findings, but COVID-19 is not excluded in normal chest because 50% they come with a normal in early stage. However, imaging does not make the diagnosis of disease. It defines the extent of disease and may suggest alternate diagnosis. Possible role of CT scan in COVID. Triage of patients. Not suggestive of COVID-19 infection. Just you can say it's not suggestive, but the 50% are normal. So it is very, very tricky one. That's why not at the present scenario, don't recommend. Possible or most likely COVID-19 infection. Yes, there are certain classical pathological changes. You can say these are COVID to determine severity of the disease. Yes, follow on, assess whether it is increasing or decreasing, whether it is regressing or increasing. Prediction or worsening, prediction of improvement, and problem solver sometimes like strong clinical suspicion in patient with negative RT-PCR test. That's why in cases where still PCR testing negative, but you are clinically suspecting, then CT is indicated. Decision to use CT for triage depends on many considerations like chances for spread of infection, if you think in hospital atmosphere, operational cost, ability of coronary CT, like what a big institution, they can have a CT scan allocated to a particular corona in the patients. You can use it, you are not worried. But you know, sir, where there is only one machine, if we get room infected, so our operational cost is very high. Once you do a corona positive, you have to keep the room at least 1 hour lock before use for next patient. Assessment of severity score in corona. This is a great question, a very big question. Everything depends on the treatment, depends on the severity. Roughly, severity is assessed by calculating the percentage of lung involvement. CT gives better visual impression for segmental involvement and their assessment. Based on the percentage of lung involvement, severity score is graded into mild, moderate, moderate to severe, and severe forms. Mild is less than 25% involvement, moderate less than 50%, moderately severe less than 75%, and above 75% is severe form. Based on the X-ray, there will be rough measurement. Severity is going to be assessed by journal involvement. We have divided the line into six zones, right side, upper, middle, lower, left, upper, middle, lower. So six zones. So mild form is only one zone involvement, one localized. Moderate is 2 to 3 zones, and severe is more than 4 zones. These are the X-ray, but it's a very rough estimation. Now let me see the various X-rays. There are two similar X-rays, looks alike, but one is normal, one is normal. Simply you see one here, there's small ground glass opposite. It's a very milder form of disease process. Now we have a case here. This is the initial X-ray on admission. This person was admitted here. Completely white out, extensive bilateral involvement, and gradually regressing. Second scan, you see the apical are almost clear, lower is still down. This is the third, almost middle zone clear. This is the last one, almost upper middle clear. This is the case we had only two positive cases and followed in 1 month. This is the patient again, look at normal chest, simply sorry, immature radiologist may miss this one, you see, small one, and ground glass nodule. One CT is showing a peripheral subdural nodule with central lucency, like we can say reverse halo sign sometimes we find, but it's a very dense one. This is a positive COVID positive case. These images I have taken out from radiopedia because we don't have that much of cases, only for teaching purposes. The case again having comorbidity factors, X-ray, see a peripheral, subdural, upper zone, lower zone, X-ray, CT scan is extensive, ground glass, and even dense consolidation bilaterally, mostly posterolateral. This is a COVID-19 positive case. This is a absolutely multifocal, multiple peripheral ground glass opacity. Few you see there is a ground glass opacity superimposed by linear opacity, that is interlobular septa, a crazy paving pattern. So this is a very classical finding for coronavirus disease. This is another case, there is a peripheral subdural ground glass opacity, soft opacity, corona positive case, very classical findings. This is extensive bilateral subdural peripheral ground glass opacity with some peribronchovascular in the central also. These are all COVID classical positive cases. This is a case, very difficult to say. Or not. You see, there is a perihilar opacity, bilateral, like a between classical or pulmonary edema, but he has got some linear ground glass opacity peripheral. This is a positive case. So these are the very, very difficult things to say early stage whether it is corona or it is a lung pulmonary edema, but this was a corona positive case. This is another case, very, very interesting. You see, there is a dense constellation here, left mid zone, there is a constellation right lower zone, CT scan dense. Just above the fissure. So classically, these are not classical picture of corona, but then it is corona patient. Ultimately, it's called secondary infection. They are in this patient, so difficult patient to predict from CT whether these are corona or not. This is another thing. See, ground glass opacity, the peripheral, peribronchovascular, all around, very shaggy pattern, not very classical pattern, not petinobular. Here is also say peripheral, all very subtle ground glass opacity all over. Initial stage, nobody will say, I'll say this is a hypersensitive pneumonia pattern, but this is a positive. So these are the three exceptional cases you have to think about. This is a case now, what is the latest development we have in the city? Color coding of the affected areas. That gives you better visual impression about how much is involved. And now there are also likely some software are there to calculate the total volume of the lung plus what is the volume of the affected area, so can they give accurate percentage involvement. These are the coming, I don't have this facility. This is the 3D image of the entire lung with the area of involvement. This I do, I have a facility, this minimum intensity present 3D images, and we can show you the area involvement exactly in this location. This is the latest development with artificial intelligence. Possibly in the coming days, we'll be able to automatically see the severity of the lung, this is the corona score. Now, let's talk about the thoracic ultrasound. We don't have any experience, only our limited experience thoracic ultrasound is the pleural fluid aspiration. you have to do quantification, and if subpleural mass for their mass, you are not doing diagnostic ultrasound for the lung. But ESG is an effective imaging tool for evaluation of lung as well as pleural space, but highly operator dependent. It is a highly versatile tool without any radiation hazard to patients or operators, and can be mobilized to any corner of the hospital with ease at the patient care site. This is a very important part. Lung ultrasound gives results that are similar to HRCT and superior to standard chest X-ray for evaluation of pneumonia and or ARDS, with added advantage of use at the point of care. ESG may be helpful in the evaluation of critically ill COVID-19 patients and the subsequent follow-up. We have to develop this technique. Our dedicated radiologists have to work on this. These are the few images. These are linear lines. Whatever you can see, the B line, we say. These are the subjective of perimucovascular linear opacity, septal thickening. These are the pleural to the pneumonic consumption. These are the way you can see in the lung ultrasound. Images are taken from the books of mine. So thank you for listening to me about the various radiological aspects. Now it is open for questions.